Hey, great to be with you. Really? Man, I was hoping you'd clap. I really was. Yeah. Some of you are saying, isn't it lunchtime yet? Can't we just cut this part out? Let's just go, you know? Applebee's is so good. Maybe not. I really love working with Josh. He is a hoot. And we get to travel, do some road trips together from time to time. And so we're just like energy in the truck. I always drive a truck. And then when Micah comes with us, he kind of sits back and thinks things through. He's like this philosophical attribute to the whole conversation. And I know he was here with you last night. I am just awestruck by the leaders I get to serve with. Can we take a moment and really stand and cheer for Josh and Bethy and tell them thanks? Would you do that? Absolutely. Thank you, thank you. When Brent Colby walked into my office one day and he said, "You know, Don, I think Jesus is opening the door for me to move," and I went, "Ah, oh, I hate that." But I will tell you something that I've learned. Down through X number of decades, you know, 2, 3, 4 decades of leadership in the church, I've discovered that every time Jesus moves somebody on, he has somebody waiting in the wings. And that person that's waiting in the wings is ready to take us to the next level. They're not necessarily better or worse. That's bad nomenclature in the church. What we need to understand is that the skill set that's needed in the kingdom. Jesus told us to seek first the kingdom, right? Do you think for one moment in his decisions, he's not seeking first the kingdom? Of course he is. So his decisions are kingdom focused and how to expand that. And I've watched the series of leaders in our network, back to Kevin Gear. And did he not do an awesome job? Say thanks to Kevin as well. And I am so impressed with those that we get to work on in the team. Now, in our network, we have basically 4 different categories of leadership. There are 3 executive officers that are elected by our network, and then we have directors, and then we have those who serve in the office. And we have a couple of those today as well. Ashley and Brittany, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for serving. Thank you for being there. You make it work. And I should say thank you to Tammy in case she looks online and sees this, you know, I don't know. She really keeps Brenda and I organized and focused in our journey. And then the 4th category actually are those who volunteer in the field. Every one of us have coordinators and facilitators that work all across the network to help make that happen. And part of that is what you saw demonstrated during worship. So Kayla Garza, thank you for an excellent job. Well done. Appreciate it. Yep. We got to travel with her and about 16 other ladies last spring. Brenda and I went with them on a leadership journey. It was so much fun. I was the only guy. Nearly 20 women, and I'm the only guy. You know, I never got a word in edgewise. Seriously. No. The truth is, we had amazing conversations, and it was a lot of fun. So a couple of quick commercials. Pardon me for the shameless plug. But if you're on Twitter, I would love to have you join me. My handle is Turnaround Rev. And I think, do we have that on the screen? There we go. Yeah, that's my Twitter handle, Turnaround Rev. And then also email, it's on the screen. I wanted the email for this reason. I've got a couple of books out, and you're part of our network. Excuse me. And we'll send them to you free if you're interested. If you're not interested, that's okay. So, you know, it doesn't cost you anything. The first book is called Turnaround Pastor. And the first half of it tells our story. And it's kind of the, I hate to say dark side of ministry, but it's the part behind the stage, behind the screen, that nobody really talks about. And Brenda and I went through some awesome things and some terrible things in ministry because, you know, when you're dealing, if you work in a hospital, you're dealing with disease and sickness. And if you're working in a church, you're dealing with disease and sickness. You just are. That's what sin produces. And sometimes Christians don't act Christian. Have you noticed that? It's just true. So I tell that story, and if you want a copy of it, I'll mail it to you. Just send me an email. And then the second book that I wrote is called A Tale of Two Churches. It talks about the combined focus of a church to be both missional and Pentecostal. And sometimes they clash, and there's tension that's there. And so we kind of chart a third path out of the book of Acts, and it's kind of a fun little thing, so I'll be happy to send it to you. I know some of you here are actually considering credentials with the network, and I would invite a conversation. I'm going to hang around afterwards and be happy to answer any of your questions or point you to the right people who can answer them. If I don't, I'm just honored to be here. I told Josh this. I said, Josh, every time you invite me, I will come. And here's why. I'm 63 years old, turned 63 last month. I've waited all my life to get here, all right? So if I get an opportunity at this stage of my life to pour into young leaders, I want to do that. If I get a choice between talking to 50-somethings with 20 years left or 20-somethings with 50 years left, give me the 20-somethings. Every single time. It's a bigger kingdom investment. So Jesus, open our ears to hear what you are saying to the church today. We honor you when we obey you. In your good name we pray. Amen. Amen. Sure, I'll take a swig. Thanks. You just see me coughing there a minute ago? Yeah? There'll be more maybe. I want to talk to you today about pain. I bet you're excited about that when you saw that in the booklet. Oh, wow, this guy's going to talk about pain. That's a session to skip. Let's just not even go there. You kind of know that there's some value in pain, you know? Kingdom, pain, how do we do that? Embracing pain for kingdom gain. Here's what we know. If you breathe, you will hurt. Isn't that true? Absolutely. Nobody hates divorce like divorced people. Nobody hates church splits like those who have been through one. Nobody hates being fired in ministry like those who have been fired. Nobody hates dealing with cancer like cancer survivors. The point of pain is to go all the way through. It's interesting to me in the Psalm 23 when David writes and he says, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. You know, the three sides to a valley. You come down, you bottom out, you come up the other side. The deal is to go through it. He doesn't say, yay, when I camp in the valley. He says, I go through it. You got to go all the way through it. And he concludes that with the banquet table on the other side of the valley. Here's what I know about pain. If you go through pain with the right heart and the right attitude, it'll change you in the way that God wants you to be changed so that he will serve you the banquet on the other side. Now, you can go through pain with a bad attitude, but you don't have to. I want to talk to you today about four points on leadership pain. I'm going to give them to you right from the get-go. You can write them down, you can skip it, and then I'm going to give you four skills under one of those points, all right? So here are the 4 points that I want to cover. Number one, the point of leadership. Why does God have leaders? Number two, pain is a gift. You're going to walk out of here today with a different framework for the word pain. Number three, pain management. How do I manage the pain? How does God give me grace to walk through pain? And number four, the privilege of leadership. I know that there is a certain percentage of people in this room today that are in pain. To some degree, I'm in pain. I'm always in various levels of pain because I'm in various levels of leadership tension, just like you. God's grace is the great equalizer. Not only will he never give you more than you can handle, he'll make sure that you are able to handle what he gives you. Corrie Ten Boom said, I know that God will never give me more than I can handle. I just wish he didn't trust me so much. And that's the way we feel sometimes. We feel like we're just overwhelmed or right at whelmed. And it's just this awesome thing that you want to get out of. And we develop this attitude of survivability rather than the ability to thrive in the context of pain. When you've been through pain enough, You recognize that there are stages of going through it, and it gives you a perspective, and that's my goal. I want to give you ministry perspective on pain so that it doesn't overwhelm you. Now, just hearing this is not going to do it for you. Jesus knows that you're going to have to actually experience it. That's why I say there's a certain percentage of you here today that are already in pain. I know that. So let's jump in. I've prayed for you to hear what the Spirit is saying to you, because you always need to be in touch with two worlds at the same time. That's what Christians do. They live in touch with two worlds. The physical world, I want to deal with reality, but I'm in touch with the spiritual world at the same time. And you're not schizophrenic at that point, okay? You're dealing with two worlds. So I want you to be in touch and be in touch. All right, number one, the point of leadership. Here's the point of leadership: to bring change. All leaders recognize that we can't live life without disappointing somebody. You can't make a decision without disappointing somebody. So here's the question: do we disappoint Jesus in our decision, or the person standing in front of us? Now, that picture should bring a definition of pain. Sam Chan said, there's no growth without change, no change without loss, no loss without pain. Bottom line is, if you're not hurting, you're not leading. Oh, good, let's all sign up to lead. Nobody told you that when they recruited you or hired you for your position. Growth occurs through change. So change is actually the evidence of life. Only dead things never change. Change is not something that you cherish. It's discomfort. It brings pain into our life. We resist pain until the pain of staying the same is greater than the pain of change. God, though, is a God of change. Now, I know you've heard the scripture saying, I, the Lord, do not change. How many of you heard that scripture? Right. It doesn't say, I, the Lord, do not bring change. He doesn't change. He doesn't need to. You do. If nobody's told you that, I just did. You were right here. I heard it happen. You need to change. Okay? So do I. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. The new has come. The brand new has come. When Paul quoted this, he was using the Koine Greek of the day, which is real straight language, straight talk. It's the kind of street language, not the high-level Greek. And it's a fascinating thing about Koine Greek. It came from Alexander the Great, who did something conquerors never did. And when he conquered a people, he didn't kill all the soldiers of the opposite army. He said, hey, instead of dying, why don't you come join me? And they said, okay. So they signed up. So the next thing you know, he's got this army filled with all these different people, and they all speak in different languages. So he brought his philosophers and teachers together, and he said, okay, you got to create a language that's so basic, so plain, that when I tell the army to go right, it understands right or left and stop. And that's where Koine Greek came from. They created that for that particular language. So it's like the common language. That's what Paul is using here. And he grabs a hold of two words here for new being, new creation. It's palingenesia. It's two words that come together. A new species of being, that when you are in Christ, there is this incredible change that happens immediately and ongoing. You should be closer to Jesus now than you were 6 months ago, a year ago. And in a year, you should be closer to Jesus than you are right now. And some of those changes have to do with knowledge. Some of them have to do with experience. But some of them have to do with pain. And you can't say to Jesus, all right, I'll learn from experience. I'll learn from knowledge. Let's just steer clear of the pain. Do I get to choose? You don't get to choose. And here's why. When you gave your life to Jesus, you signed the blank check. You gave it to him. It's no longer your life, and he gets to spend it any way he wants. He gets to use your life any way he wants. And if he doesn't, here's the deal. If he doesn't, then he's not in charge. You are. You are now your own God. And we know how that went in the garden, and it hasn't gone very good since. Let's not go there. Let's cooperate. The fastest way through pain is obedience. Bringing change as a leader to a culture or to an individual is the point of leadership. And you are bringing change to children, but you're also bringing change to adults. You're bringing change to parents. You're helping to bring change to your church. You are a change agent. Now, you may not be a change agent with the same responsibility as a lead pastor, but you have responsibility. You are a change. You have to see yourself as a change agent. If you're not willing to lead change as a leader, then you're not willing to lead. And frankly, you should get out of the way, because now you've become a hindrance, not an asset, to the kingdom of God. You have now become an inhibitor. Leaders who refuse to lead change because they are unwilling to pay the price in pain or emotional price tag are directly contributing to the death of the very thing they say they love: their ministry, their church, and the people. Bringing stability, that's the point of management. Nurturing people, that's the point of pastoral care. You should do that as well. But instigating change, that's the point of leadership. And leaders must be the first to change personally, or they can't lead very far. It's not just about bringing change, it's about being willing to change. Leadership starts with submitting myself to the leadership of Jesus. That's the practice you heard us talking about earlier, called self-leadership. It means leading yourself to this specific point: submission to Jesus. The one question I ask leaders in our office, pastors that I visit with, more than anything else, and I will put it to you as we wrap up today: what is Jesus telling you to do? What is Jesus asking you to do? There is no more important question at any given point in your life, and that is self-leadership. I practice self-leadership by coming to Jesus so I'm not leading myself. Everybody got that? I mean, our faith is just a series of dichotomy. I'm independent so that I can be dependent. I'm trusting Jesus, who then trusts me. To be following Jesus means that I am constantly growing and I am continually changing, wait for it, to be like him. Did Jesus change? Luke 2 says that he learned obedience by the things that he suffered. Did Jesus experience growing pain? Apparently so. Wait a minute, I thought Jesus was God. I, the Lord, do not change. How did Jesus change? Okay, ask your pastor that question. Jesus laid aside his godness to become fully man, but he never stopped being fully God. That's the amazing thing about the incarnation. And Paul reflects on that, this ability to become like Christ in Philippians 3. I don't mean to say that I've already achieved these things or I've already reached perfection, but I keep working towards the day that I will finally be all that Christ Jesus saved me for and what he wants me to be. No, dear brothers and sisters, I am still not all that I should be, but I'm focusing all my energy on this one thing: forgetting the past, looking forward to what lies ahead, I strain to reach the end of the race and receive the prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling me up to heaven. Change is painful. It just is. Our ability to move forward is directly connected to our ability to navigate the pain in our life. Do you have a fight with your husband or your wife? Or maybe you're not married and you got a boyfriend or girlfriend and you had a fight? Or there's tension between you and a child that you have, or a boss, or somebody in your department that you oversee, or who oversees you. There will rarely be a time in your life when you will live pain-free. And understanding that God uses pain to make me more like Jesus adds perspective to it. There's a Jewish philosopher by the name of Viktor Frankl, who wrote a book called Man's Search for Meaning. He went clear through the Auschwitz concentration camp and saw people who were really strong die and people who were kind of weak make it. And he took little notes on bits and scraps of paper. And when he survived, he wrote this book, Man's Search for Meaning. And it's an awesome book. I encourage you to read it. But it's summed up in one line: when you find purpose in pain, you find sustainability. It's more than just thriving. I'm actually growing. When there's purpose attached to that. And here's the thing about your faith. You may be going through pain and you can't find the purpose, but your faith in Jesus tells you that he would never waste pain on you without a purpose. He would never arbitrarily put you through a situation that's painful because he loves you. There's no sadistic God in the sky saying, ha, 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 let's see which one can handle it the best. He doesn't do that. He loves you. And he would never allow pain into your life unless the product of that pain is greater than you not having it. He'll make sure that you are becoming more and more like Jesus. Spiritual leadership requires us to be progressing, to becoming more like Christ. Here's what I know about Jesus. If I go through a situation and I fail to make it all the way through, Jesus, because he loves me, will bring me back through it again and again and again. When I was 37 years old, I had taken my church from about 350 to 700, multiple services, multiple staff, and we built phase two, cash, and then the board fired me. Very painful, very public. And internally, I told myself, I will never again trust a board. Any church that I lead will be a pastor-led church, which is code for I can control my environment and protect myself from pain. It didn't go so well. The first church that I pastored grew well. Second church grew well before they fired me. And I sat out of ministry for 2 years. And then the third church that I had in Seattle, we were there for 20 years. It went down, 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 down. And part of the reason, not the whole reason, but part of the reason is I held people at arm's length. I held people at arm's length. I would not let them close because it hurt, especially the board. I controlled the agenda. I controlled the discussion. Oh, I appeared to be open, but it was all a technique of leadership. I would ask questions. What do you think? What do you think? But I would never let the conversation go. Controlled annual business meetings. Made sure that the conversation always went in the direction it was supposed to, and the church just kept going down, 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 down. Until we reached a point that we could no longer even afford our facility. And now the pain that I'm protecting myself from is greater than the pain of the past. This current pain is greater. And I start crying out to Jesus. And there's a whole story I could tell at this point, but I'll send you the book. It's in there. There's another plug. The one thing that happened is I was sitting at a restaurant one morning, writing my sermon. And I'd been reading John Eldridge's book, Waking the Dead. He talks about the heart. And in that book, he says, God knows your heart. And I prayed and I said, Jesus, what's in my heart? And he asked me this question. He said, Don, if I asked you to lead a church that never grew beyond 150 people, the rest of your life, would you do it? Now, what do you do when Jesus asks you a question like that? There's only one answer. Sure, no problem. It was a problem. I was kind of a church growth guy. I wanted my church to grow. But here's what happened. In that moment when God spoke to me, he exposed what was in my heart. He said, in that one question, would you be willing to lead a church that never grows? The thing that he exposed was the pain that was driving me. Because I had revenge in my heart. I wanted our church in Seattle to grow and be large and be prevailing in the region for one single reason, so that those people in that last church who fired me would hear about it and say, whoa, didn't we blow it? We sent that leader down the road. What a terrible mistake we made. How many of you know revenge is not a good foundation for evangelism? It's just not. And when he spoke that word to me, I just burst into tears. I couldn't stop the tears in that realm. I was embarrassed. Because Jesus knows how to expose the pain in our life. And when we maintain control in order to prevent pain, we actually end up with more pain. Here's what we know about growing. Leadership and pain go hand in hand. A leader's capacity is linked to their willingness to navigate that pain. And you can't navigate that pain without a direct connection to Jesus, because nobody navigates pain better than Jesus. And nobody will help you navigate your pain better than Jesus. Growth equals change. Change equals loss. Loss equals pain. There's actually a grieving process. I remember in our church when we got rid of the pews and brought in chairs, there was a woman named Marilyn who stood in the middle of the sanctuary and just heaved and weeped because God was leaving the place with the pews. Now, I didn't know he was moving out, but she was convinced that he was moving out, that he was gone. And an associate pastor, she wouldn't want me close to her because that was my decision. I was being blamed for that. He walked up and he just loved her and he helped her grieve the loss. Now, when you make a decision that brings change, you have to understand that the group you're leading is going to process that change much like a death. They go through the stages of bargaining and denial and refusal and before they finally come to that point of acceptance, because ultimately change equals pain. Here's what we know about leaders. If you lead, you bleed. How do you deal with pain? And how do your people deal with pain? If you ignore pain inside you, not just corporate pain, and you've picked up that I'm talking about two different kinds of pain. Personal pain is what happens to you and how you deal with it. Corporate pain is when you make a decision and it impacts those that you're leading. If you ignore pain in either category and you allow it to build, it can produce a ministry blowout, either in your church, that's what produces splits, or inside you. And if the ministry pain inside you is not dealt with, you're going to medicate that pain one way or another, and that's what opens the door to addictive behavior. There are three kinds of addictions that people face. Chemical addiction, alcohol, drugs, that kind of stuff. Behavioral addiction, which is practices, habits that are destructive. And relational addicted, when they're involved in relationships that bring destruction into their own life. And you will medicate your pain in the ministry one way or another if you don't deal with the pain on the inside. That is the driving force. The moment people can no longer hurt you in the ministry and you hold them back, you can no longer serve them or lead them. You must be vulnerable in order to lead. You've got to be strong enough to be soft enough. Is that making sense? I hope you're capturing that. Here's the second thing I want to talk to you about. Pain is a gift. Dealing with leadership pain requires that you understand the nature of it. Let me give you a definition of leadership pain. Leadership pain is the distress that a leader experiences when making courageous decisions to pursue what is possible. You have a dream. You see that. Listen, if we did this in our kids' department, we could have this. If we had this kind of training, we could bring in these leaders. If I could just make these decisions. And you have this dream that's there. And you put forth that vision. You cast it out there. But there's a distress and a tension between what you see and what you can do or what you're even allowed to do. The follower of Jesus deals with this in a different way than those in the world, because we understand that courageous decisions are actually nothing more than obedience. Successfully navigating pain in those vision-casting environments starts with understanding the very nature of pain. You must understand that pain is a gift from God because it signals that something needs our attention. Have you ever met someone who didn't experience pain? Brenda and I were driving over. We stopped at Ellensburg this morning at Perkins for breakfast, and the waitress brought our breakfast out. We split this breakfast, and she put a plate in front of Brenda that had no food, and then a plate in front of me that hadn't, and then we're going to divide it all, okay? And she says, it's hot. Careful, that's a hot plate. And I looked, and I said, How did you hold this if it's so hot? She goes, oh, I have no feeling in my fingertips anymore. That's long gone. I went, how sad. Something dangerous could happen to her fingertips and she wouldn't know about that. There's actually a medical condition where people have no sensation of pain. And you might think for a moment that that's wonderful. You'd never feel pain physically. Think how dangerous that would be. You could actually lose some your fingers or your limbs, or something, and eventually, you know, oh, there's something bleeding. I must have left it somewhere, you know. Something happened at that point. It's a dangerous, dangerous situation because pain is a signal to us that something needs our attention. Make sure that you don't waste it. You don't waste your pain. Paying attention and addressing the issues of pain is necessary and it's healthy. Have to ask yourself this question. Why do I feel pain? Why do you feel it? Now, let me just separate the crowd here for a moment, okay? All the ladies lean to the right, all the men lean to the left because you process pain differently. Women, by their nature, are more likely, not exclusively, but more likely to pick up on emotional signals of pain much quicker than men. In fact, men basically have two emotions. I like that, I don't like that. And we're happy in that world. We're happy in that world. Everything's working out fine. Do you like it? Sure, it's great. Do you like it? No, not really. Why? I don't know. I just don't like it. That's good enough for me. I don't have to have a reason, all right? But women have this context by which they can label the emotions so clearly and grab a hold of that. I think that's one of the reasons why working together is so powerful. I want to understand that. I want to understand that pain is processed differently by different people. Don't waste your pain. Don't ignore those issues. The pain in the path in pain always leads to more pain when you ignore the current pain. Ask yourself that question. Why do I feel that pain? There was a period in my life where I did not deal with anger very well at all. And I recognized that pain, that the anger was a result of hurt. And if I didn't deal with that, then the anger was going to turn into depression. So it goes hurt, anger, depression. And we're all built that way. All of us are, you know. And I would have to think things through so very carefully. And when I admitted to myself that I was actually an angry leader, two things happened. Number one, God healed me. For decades, I had had debilitating headaches that, as a young man, would lay me out. My mom would bring a cold washcloth, and I would lay there for hours until maybe it was a migraine, I don't know. But it was just, And when I admitted to myself that I wasn't processing my anger, God healed me. It went away. I've never had a headache since that time. It's just been this amazing thing. The other thing is I got in touch. When I allowed myself to recognize that pain was going on in the inside, I got in touch with other people's pain. I could recognize that. I became a lot more empathetic. I recognized situations a lot clearer. Let me give you four skills that will help you in this, okay? Here's the first one. Be self-aware. Be self-aware. Charles Spurgeon said, "Beware of no man more than yourself. We carry our worst enemies within us." Be aware of yourself. So I realize that as I talk to you today, that some of you are dealing with some leadership pain. Some of you in the last month have had some very, very difficult conversations where maybe your leader said, "Hey, we need to talk about this." And it was a painful conversation. Or the converse, you have to have a conversation with somebody and you're just putting it off. You're procrastinating because you don't want to go through that pain. And you're aware of what's going on inside yourself. That's the first skill. Be self-aware. Number two, be open-hearted. Be open-hearted. Leaders who are aware of others on their team who are in pain have an open heart. Pastors, leaders, children's directors, and workers who are aware of kids who are going through a hard time have an open heart. There's compassion, and you need to have that. You need to sense the pain in other people's lives. Emotionally intelligent leaders are open-hearted leaders. It allows leaders to acknowledge, to be empathetic, to care. And when you act that, you model that so that those who are following you will be exactly the same way. Here's the third skill. Be aware of the collective pain. For example, a pain in your church. If your church goes through a split, you need to be aware of that. Your church goes through a hard time, financial debacle. Your pastor dies. Something tragic happens. You need to be aware of the collective pain. Don't live in your own world. Live in the world. And then the fourth skill set is to be aware of community pain. How can you touch a community? My sister was a school teacher in Marysville for over 30 years, and she was there when the shootings happened 4 years ago. And I tuned in to find out what some of our churches were doing in the area. And Nick Baumgart, who is the pastor at the Grove Church, opened his church from dawn till dusk brought in counselors, brought in his people, just and let the community know this is a place where you can process the pain. Schools should be safe. Hospitals should be safe. Churches should be safe. That's where shootings happen. Do you know that the first recorded shooting that happened publicly happened in our state in the city of Moses Lake, 1985? That was the first recorded mass shooting in the United States. Welcome to Washington. I think God wants to do something great here. I think the devil's sniffing it out, and I think he's resisting that. God wants to use us to recognize community pain. I heard about Dave Ferguson, who leads a church in Chicago, who's planting this church. And God spoke to him, and he said, I want you to go out to the street and lean against a telephone pole and just watch the people. Now, downtown Chicago, nobody drives. Everybody rides a bus, and they're on their way. They got out of the bus, and they're looking, and they just look down. He said to Dave, where are they looking? He said, they're looking down. He said, you got to meet them where they're looking. Go to where they are. Don't expect them to come to you. I think you invite people to church, absolutely. But 75% of your time, you ought to be spending where the people are. Don't necessarily come to enforce them to, or force them to come to you. So Dave started praying and thinking, and he had some people. He had four people in his church that would draw chalk drawings. So he said, would you come with me? And he showed him the same thing. And they said, hey, why don't we do some chalk drawings on the sidewalk in Chicago? And so they began to draw these sayings and then some scripture verses and little positive comments and all that. And now what's happening is the people are getting off the bus, this busy line, and they're walking by. They're walking slower, and they're looking down. Some are even taking pictures. And they engage in conversations. And then four people turned into 10 that turned into two or three dozen. And when I saw this video, they're getting off the vans and they're walking. They got knee pads and they're carrying buckets of chalk, you know, and they're drawing that. Well, the police showed up, heard that they were vandalizing public property. So the cops came over and a couple black and whites and four officers walked out. Are you vandalizing? He said, well, we're doing chalk drawings. Do you have a permit to do this? He didn't know we needed one, you know. He said, well, let's see what you got. Hey, that's good. Wow, I like that. Huh. And he sees the people in the church stop drawing and talk to the people and encourage them. Once in a while, they get a chance to pray with people. Well, that's how he launched his church. A year and a half later, this woman is being baptized in his church, and he's talking to her. How did you come to Christ? She said, I remember when you did the very first chalk drawing on the sidewalk. Yeah? It's like you recognized the pain that was in community, but you recognized my pain. What happened, he said. When I got off, I thought my world was going to die. The week before, my 12-year-old daughter had died, and my life had no meaning. I was just going through the motions. And when I looked down and I saw some of the scriptures and the pictures and those positive sayings, she said, I have a picture of every single drawing that you ever did in the last year and a half. And every week I would put a new one up right by my computer. Your drawing saved my life. And that's how I found Jesus. They recognized the pain that was always there. It was always there. There's a pastor that I was coaching in Detroit, little church, 40 people. They saved up a bunch of money. They're going to have a barbecue. They invite everybody to this barbecue. Hardly anybody shows. But a teacher from an apartment complex came, and she said, I appreciate what you're trying to do here, but actually people are kind of scared about coming into your church. And the pastor wasn't defensive, bless his heart, a little painful to hear, but he said, okay. He said, well, what do you think? She said, why don't you do another barbecue, only this time ask for permission and have it in the parking lot where all of those apartment buildings are surrounding. There's a dozen or more apartment buildings, huge numbers of people. And he said, okay, got a permission from the manager. They saved up some more money. This time they had between 200 and 300 people show up. They're amazed. They get to talk to people about Jesus, just love on them. Everybody knew the church was doing it, but they came to where they were, not where they wanted them to come. So the teacher came up and she said, this is really good. The pastor said, yeah, thanks. I guess I owe it all to you. This is your idea. She said, would you be open to one more? Okay. I'm a teacher at a local elementary school, and I teach a lot of the kids. In fact, all the kids that I teach come from this apartment complex, and I live here too. Almost all of these children, kindergarten through grade 6, come to school without any underwear, and many of them have no socks. If your church could buy little briefs and panties and socks for kids from kindergarten up through grade six and make that a gift to these, it would be amazing. They did that, opened the community's heart. They went to where the pain was. They went to, our church did a study in our area, and we discovered that we had four times the national average of single-parent moms. So we started Single Mom Sunday in October, the exact opposite of Mother's Day. And they showed up, and we saved up our money. We gave every single mom a $100 bill. And I expected to hear those single moms go. Our board was actually afraid that it would be a run on the bank, that they're going to come back, okay, if you gave me $100, why don't you give me, you know, help me like a welfare state. It wasn't that at all. Our elders prayed with the single moms, blessed their children, gave them this $100, and also said, you know, we'll pay for your babysitting if you want to go out. So I figured that these moms are going to get together and get their hair done or go to a spa, buy a pair of shoes. You know what I heard? Tears coming down their eyes. My children are going to have milk for the first time in 3 weeks. I get to fill up my car. Pastor, I get to turn the electricity back on because of this. Sometimes discovering pain in the community is the pathway to bringing the gospel to the community. Where's the pain in your community? If we push back from that, if we push back from that, there's no love. I want to be aware of that. Maybe you're aware of some pain. You go through some leadership pain. Here's some examples of pain. Being misunderstood. You've done everything right and you're misunderstood. Your leaders don't get it about you. How about the pain of having people leave your ministry? You got a key leader that's helping you serve in your department and the family leaves the church. Ouch. The pain of a staff member leaving and maybe even taking members of the church with them. The pain of deep disappointment. You hope that you would be recognized. You hope that people would see what you've done, your sacrifice. Nobody even said anything. It's hard in that moment to say, yes, but Jesus sees. Especially if our expectation is that others would see. Recognize the pain. You're right, you got to go back to Jesus. But you got to recognize the pain first. How about the pain of carrying other people's pain? How about the pain of others not helping you carry your pain? You were there for them, now who's there for you? There's all kinds of pain in ministry. Somebody said, leadership is fun until you try it. Embracing pain is the necessary gift that you and I have to have if we're going to be used by Jesus to make a difference in other people's lives. Because embracing pain allows Jesus to make a difference in my life. And once I embrace pain as a part of growth, then I'm in track. Now I'm in sync with Him. People are watching leaders, and unfortunately, a poor reaction in the wrong moment by not embracing pain can actually exacerbate the situation. It makes it worse. Leaders that want to go the distance have to understand how to work hard at suffering well. Here's a third point I want to give you. Pain management. How do you manage pain? How do you manage it? Discomfort is the catalyst for growth. Wherever your source of leadership pain, there are healthy ways to manage that pain in that moment. I've learned a couple of things. First of all, I have to embrace the pain. Embrace the pain. When I get a nasty email, I get a couple from time to time. So do you. We all get them, right? Or texts. I look at it and I go, okay, I'm not emotionally ready to open that email yet. I give myself 24 hours of grace. Then I open the email, and I read through it, and I let it set. Now, I may send that person a note, thanks for your email, want you to know I got it, I'll respond pretty soon. And depending on how intense the response is, I'll craft a response, and I'll sit on it for a couple of days, and then review my response. Here's what I've learned about myself. If I react, I make the pain worse. But if I respond, I can actually reduce the pain and learn in the context. I recognize that. I want to wait that. Patience is an awesome Christian principle, but it means that you embrace the pain. You hold the pain in tension for a while. Here's another skill. Seeing pain as your greatest teacher. When you look back in your life, you will recognize that pain brought about some of the greatest lessons in your life. You don't ever want to go through it again. I don't ever want to be fired by a board again. I don't ever want to go through that again. There are certain chapters in my life I don't ever want to repeat, but I'm glad that I went through it. It's like talking to somebody who went through military service. Are you glad you did it? Yeah, but I don't want to do it again. Because pain is our greatest teacher. I can't avoid it. I don't want to minimize it. I want to make sure that I ask God how he is using this pain in this situation. I want to keep the outcome in mind. That is the end. I want to think about the end. What do I want to be? If I stop breathing tomorrow, do I want these to be my last words? Do I want this to be my last decision? I want to keep the outcome in mind. And I want to follow this rigorous plan of personal development on how I handle the pain. For me, I bracket pain. I bracket situations. One of my good friends that I also serve with in the network office, Dave Cole, who's our assistant superintendent, we've been friends for decades, and we were doing a walk together the other day, and I was visiting and processing a tough situation that we're leading through in the network. I said, Dave, here's what I've done. I've bracketed this. What is the worst thing that could possibly happen in this situation? What is the best thing? Now, once you've got a situation bracketed, you have your pain bracketed. The pain's drawn my attention to it, and generally it's somewhere in the middle. But if I can say to myself, if this is the absolute worst thing that can happen, and I'm willing to accept that, I'm willing to pay that price, then I have to make that decision, then I can move forward. Then I can put a plan together, and that's the next step, to create an action plan. How are you going to do this? Somebody is angry with you, brings pain into your life. You thought you'd really invested in them. And they want to talk to you, and you know what it's going to be. It's going to be a tough conversation. So you say to yourself, I'm not ready emotionally to do this. I actually have to process that through. So before I talk to this person, I'm going to talk to a trusted mentor or a counselor in my life, somebody that I know will be honest with me. I have a counselor in my life. His name is John. He's almost 80 years old. He's been a mentor for almost 2 decades. I asked him, I said, and in our church, we still go to our home church first Sunday of every month. He's flocked by 30s and 40s. They're half his age. Young married couples, asking them how they, I said, John, how do you attract these people? He says, I don't know. He said, all I do is listen, try and ask good questions, and care. That's all. I said, well, there you go. Those are rare commodities right there. Create this action plan by how you can respond, which will prevent you from reacting. And here's the last one, celebrate the wins. Celebrate the wins. When you go through a tough situation and you get to the other side, it's amazing. I was working on a situation and the board was very angry with us. And so we gave time and then gave a little more information. And the board said, okay, well, maybe there is a point here. And so we had more conversation. And by the end of that conversation, the board was saying, thank you. We did not know all of this. Your perspective was different. We're so glad that you come alongside us. I'll tell you what, we celebrated the win right there. Because a win for one of us is a win for all of us. Isn't that right? Absolutely. Absolutely. All right. Here's the last thing I want to tell you. The privilege of leadership. The privilege of leadership. Sam Chan said again, there's no growth without change, no change without loss, no loss without pain. Bottom line, if you're not hurting, you're not leading. You've got to endure pain in leadership. It's called bleedership. Bleedership. This happens when leaders bleed emotionally for the sake of the mission, for the cause of Christ. When Jesus got a hold of my life and our church was declining, down, 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 I said, Jesus, how do we change people's hearts? He said, how do I change your heart? And after that crying episode in the restaurant, I opened my heart. God began to talk to me in some very powerful ways. And incrementally, over the next 3 to 5 years, I saw myself change. And suddenly, it didn't matter how many people were there on Sunday morning. I wanted more people there. I wanted more people to come to Christ. But I had to take care of the people who were there. And I stopped being angry. I remember showing up early, spending time with all the senior saints because they're the ones who come early. And when I was talking to the person in front of me, I stopped looking at the person over their shoulder and asking myself if it was more important that I talk with them or the one directly in front of me. There was a time in my life when I would be engaged in a conversation with somebody, and in the middle of their sentence in response to me, I would just turn and walk away, and I wasn't even aware of it. Thank God for my wife who pointed that out. She said, "You know how insensitive that was?" And I said, "What? You just walked away." "I did." I don't want to be that kind of person. Have you ever been talking to somebody and you felt like the person who walked by was more important than you and they'd rather not talk to you and go talk to them? You ever had that happen to you? Have you ever done it? I didn't expect anybody to raise their hand on the second one, but you know, it happens. We're all subject to that kind of pain. We recognize that. When I recognize that pain is growing inside me, I have to do something about it. Greg Groeschel tells this story. He said, "Some of you will do as leaders what I did a few years ago. I became a full-time pastor and became, at the same time, a part-time follower of Jesus. I would pray, and when I prayed publicly, and I would study when I was preparing for a sermon, my self-worth was totally based on the offering or the attendance. And a red flag came into my life when I realized that I was more about consumption than caring. And the more I tended to believe that I was right in assessing situations, the more likely I was to be blinded and to be wrong. The solution was a fundamental biblical answer. The more humble I became, the more I listened to God. The more broken I realized I was, the better my relationship with my spouse and my family and my church. Because pride shows itself in two very different forms, superiority and inferiority." Have you ever had that happen? Superiority and inferiority. It's an interesting thing about becoming humble before God. Jesus said there's two ways to get humble. You can fall on the rock and you'll be broken, or the rock falls on you and you'll be crushed. Choose your pain. The pain of superiority is the assumption that I know better than God what should happen in my life. And when it doesn't happen, God and I had a deal. I obey, you bless. And when God doesn't bless, I become angry. Superiority, in my reflecting on my own leadership, superiority always leads to anger. But inferiority is exactly the opposite. I'm unable to make it work. What's wrong with this situation? This is so terrible. Why did you make this happen, God? Now I'm a victim. And the two extremes are anger or victimized. Which one? Neither one of those are healthy. I know that I'm walking in pride, listen carefully, when I am experiencing undue anger or I am constantly or often feeling like a victim. Have you ever considered those as marks? Those are like gauges, and those are like ministry gauges. If I feel like a victim, I'm actually dealing with pride. If I'm dealing with anger, I'm actually dealing with pride. That's the basis of that. A truly humble person doesn't feel compelled to either put themselves down or to put themselves in the middle of the conversation. We know that we are deeply flawed. I want to be brutally honest about my sin, and I want to allow Jesus to call me out for the sinful attitudes, not just actions. And I'm convinced at that moment that the grace of God is more wonderful than anything I can imagine. That happens in the context of pain in my life. When you know that you stand before Jesus and you have nothing to prove, it's in that moment that there is a sense of peace that falls in you as a leader, and you realize that I'm right here. Here's what I want you to know. There's over 7 billion people on this planet. Jesus doesn't make mistakes. The reason you're in the position you're in is because of out of all 7 billion people, you're the best person for that job. You got to believe that. So when you bear pain in the context of ministry, you're actually doing what the Apostle Paul says in Colossians 1. Let me read this scripture to you. This is a almost an obscure scripture in the New Testament. Now I rejoice in what I am suffering for you. Hear the pain? And I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, which is the church. Here's what Paul is saying. I am willing to embrace pain for you. I am willing to suffer for you to fill up what is lacking in regards to Christ's afflictions for the sake of the church. It's not that Jesus didn't pay for our salvation on the cross. He paid for it, right? 100%. But all the suffering that is due for the church to move forward was not paid for on the cross. You get to pay a share of it yourself. You have to be willing to embrace pain. I have to embrace pain in order to move the mission forward. So here's my question to you. I've got two of them, and here they are. What's one thing that you heard this morning that you're taking away from this session? And here's the second question. What courageous decision is Jesus asking you to make so that you will not be held hostage by fear or pain? I want to pray with you because some of you know right off the bat. If I said, what stuck out in your mind about what you heard today? Well, you know what it is. But the second question is more potent. What's the courageous decision that Jesus is asking you to make? Now, here's what you need to understand about a courageous decision. It doesn't take courage as much as it takes obedience. Because if Jesus is asking you to do it, you only have one choice. Yes, I will do it, which is obedience. No, I will not do it, which is disobedience. So I'm going to ask you, with every head up and every eye open and everybody looking all around, when you know what the courageous decision is that Jesus wants you to make, when you are willing to embrace the pain and say yes to that decision, Jesus, I will do what you're asking. For some of you, you're going to have an honest conversation with your pastor or your husband or your wife or maybe your kids or department leaders. You're going to have to initiate the conversation. You're asking God to help you with it. For some of you, you're going to have to make a decision. For some of you, it's going to involve money. For some of you, it's going to involve time. Either way, there's going to be pain involved. And when you're willing to embrace the pain, now you're willing to make the courageous decision, which is simple obedience. So here's my instructions to you. I only want to pray with those who are saying yes. If you know the courageous decision that Jesus is asking you to make personally, and you are willing to be obedient, as soon as you know what that is, I want you to stand to your feet and walk right down here and just line right across the front, and I'm going to pray with you. The rest of you just remain seated. But those who know, you come now. You won't be the only one. Just come right now. Just line right across the front.